and welcome to Learn Yourself. Today we are going to study about elements, compound and mixture. This chapter is from ICSE Standard 8 syllabus. So as we are starting our chapter, let us take an overview of a chapter that what all things we are going to study in this chapter. We are going to study in this chapter about elements, that metal, non-metal and metalloids. What are they? Difference between metal, non-metal, non-metal and metalloids, metalloids and metal. Then, what are the compounds? Compounds are formed from molecules. So, what are the molecules? Then, how the compounds are being formed. Then, mixture. In mixture, there are two types of mixture, that homogeneous mixture and heterogeneous mixture. So, we need to study the difference between element and compound, compound and mixture, then molecule and compound, then what is the difference between homogeneous and heterogeneous mixture, what all term here you are seeing. We need to understand that how the one thing is different from another. Then the important part is type of mixtures. How many types of mixture we are going to study? In this chapter we are going to study solid-solid mixture, when one solid is mixing with another solid, like rocks are mixing with sand, like that. Then solid and liquid mixture, water we are adding in sand, so that is solid-liquid mixture. Then liquid-liquid mixture, liquid and gas mixture, gas and gas mixture. Now when we have all this mixture with us, then how can we separate them? If we have solid-solid mixture, then what all separation techniques we have so that we can separate them? Here we have to understand that only mixture we can separate. We cannot separate compound, we cannot separate molecule. That we will study in chapter. Then in solid-solid mixture, we are going to study all these techniques and all this methodology via we can separate these mixtures. So for solid-solid, there are 1, 2, 3 and 4 techniques we are going to study, that via sublimation, via solvent extraction, via magnetic separation and via fractional distillation, we can separate solid-solid mixture. Now again, it is based on which kind of solids you have. So based on that, this techniques has been designed. Based on that, these techniques have been designed. So we have to understand that what is the condition to use this technique and what this technique is all about. Description of that technique and very important diagram for each and every technique. Then if we have solid liquid mixture, then what all are the techniques so that we can separate them? Filtration, sedimentation, evaporation and distillation. For liquid-liquid mixture, there are two techniques, separating funnel and fractional distillation. Liquid-gas mixture, we have one technique, that is boiling. For gas and gas mixture, we have two techniques, that one is diffusion and another one is solubility in the solvent. This chapter is very very easy, but the thing is there are too much of information, all these different kind of techniques. So for each and every technique, we are going to study the condition, that in which situation we are going to use this technique, then how can we use this technique and what can we separate from this technique. So you have to understand all these things for all this technique. So whatever I will write on the board, that will be notes for you and that will be mnemonics for you, and that is the technique how by which you can remember each and every technique very easily. Let us start with our first topic, that classification of matter. When we are classifying matter, majorly we are classifying matter into two types, living matter and non-living matter. In this chapter, we are talking about non-living matter. So in non-living matter, we are identifying matter by two ways. First is pure substance, another is impure substance. Now, how can we say that this substance is pure? That means if we are talking about carbon dioxide, this is a compound, or we are talking about oxygen, or one atom of oxygen, then that oxygen is alone. There is no other impurity is associated with it. If we are talking about carbon dioxide, then that compound is alone and there is no other impurities that are associated with it, or there is no other compound or element is with it, then this element or compound is to be called that they are pure substances. Now, in pure substance category, we are classifying substances by two ways. First is element, other one is compound. Now, what are the elements? If we are talking about hydrogen, then that is element. If we are talking about oxygen, then that is element. If we are talking about chlorine, then that is element. Those are elements. Now, what under element, there are metals, iron, aluminium. There are non-metals, sulfur, carbon, right? Then there are metalloids like boron. Then noble gases. What are the noble gases? Neon, argon, xenon, krypton, those are noble gases. So all these things are under element. So element is only one thing, and element is a basic unit of any matter. Then we cannot break element further. It is a one basic unit of a matter and we cannot break it and we cannot divide it. So that is our element. What is element? Element is a basic unit of matter and we cannot break it and we cannot divide it. Then compounds. What are the compounds? When two or more elements are combined together, then they are making compounds. For example, carbon dioxide, carbon and oxygen are mixing together and they are making one compound, that is compound. So carbon dioxide, water, these are the example of compounds. Now these are combination of elements. What are the compounds? Then they are combination of elements. They are attached with each other in a fixed ratio. They are attached in fixed ratio. We have discussed this earlier in language of chemistry, that when this is C N2, one atom of carbon is combining with two atom of oxygen, then only it is carbon dioxide. If it is C2O, then this is not carbon dioxide. If this is C2O2, then also this is not carbon dioxide. So to make a perfect compound, we need a fixed ratio of elements. So what are the compounds? Compounds are combination of elements. They are attached with each other in a fixed proportion, fixed ratio. And we can break them. We can break them by chemical means and we can separate them. Right? So these are compounds. Now, under the category of impure substance, the mixtures are impure. Why? Because in mixture there are n number of substances can participate. One substance is mixing with another, so there are chances of impurities. So that's why they are called impure substance. Now under mixture, we have two types of mixtures: homogeneous mixture and heterogeneous mixture. We have studied about this two in 7th standard. Now we will study this in brief and we will study that how can we separate a particular mixture. Then what are the mixtures? Mixtures are made from element or compound. Either it is a mixture of element, or it is a mixture of compounds, or it is a mixture of element or compound. Then there is no fixed ratio to mix anything into a mixture. If we are saying that this is a mixture of gases, suppose air, then there is no fixed ratio. We know that there are percentage proportion for each and every gases, but there is no fixed ratio. So that is mixture. So from this topic we got to know that what is element, what is compound, and what are the mixtures. Then how many types of elements, what all types of elements are there? Metal, non-metal, metalloids and noble gas. Then compounds, there are n number of compounds. Then under mixture, there are two types of mixture, that homogeneous and heterogeneous. In this consolidated table, I have noted down their characteristic properties, metal, non-metal, metalloid and noble gas. If the question will come like you have to write the difference between metal and non-metal, then you can note down all this characteristic properties. And if we have to write the difference in between non-metal and metalloid, then you can note it down this characteristic properties. If the question will come that what are the metalloids, then you can note down this characteristic property and give one or two examples. The same for noble gas. So these are the total characteristic properties for metal, non-metal and metalloids and noble gas. Let us see one by one. Whatever I have marked with blue letters, they are exceptions. We will discuss it. So for metal are generally solid, but the exception is Hg. What is Hg? It is mercury. Mercury at room temperature, it is liquid. So mercury is exception when we are talking about metal, that metals are solid, but the exception is mercury. Metals are generally lustrous, that means they have shine, but the exception is iodine. Iodine do not have shine, but iodine is a metal. They are malleable, but the exception is zinc. They are ductile. Then they are good conductors of heat and electricity. Heat and electricity. Metals are good conductors. They have high melting point and high boiling point. They have high density. Then they are monoatomic. Now what is the meaning of monoatomic? Monoatomic means if we are talking about iron, then Fe alone can exist. That means they are monoatomic. So these are the characteristic property of metal, and there are three exceptions. 1, 2 and 3. This is iodine. Iodine is not lustrous even though it is metal. Zinc is non-malleable even though it is metal. And mercury is a metal, but it is in liquid state at room temperature. Now let us talk about non-metal. What all characteristic properties the metals are possessing? The exactly opposite characteristic properties are non-metals are possessing. So they do not have luster. They have luster, they do not have luster. But the exception is graphite. Graphite is non-metal, but it does have luster. Now when we are talking about malleability, non-metals are non-malleable. They are non-ductile. They are bad conductors of heat and electricity, but the exception is graphite. That graphite, even though graphite is a non-metal, it is a good conductor of electricity. They are having a low boiling point and melting point. They have low density and they are monoatomic as well as they are diatomic. If we are talking about chlorine, then chlorine cannot exist alone. It has to be Cl2. If we are talking about oxygen, then it cannot stand alone. It has to be O2. Like that, they are diatomic. Now when we are talking about metalloid, so what are the metalloids? Metalloids are combination of metal and non-metal. They are possessing characteristic properties of both metal and non-metal. But they are chemically reactive. They are monoatomic. When we are talking about boron, then it is metalloid. Now when we are talking about noble gas, they are chemically inert. We can find them in traces in our atmosphere. Argon, krypton, xenon, all are in very minute proportion, but they are present in the atmospheric air. they are monoatomic. They are very stable and they are monoatomic. So this is all about metal, non-metal, metalloid and noble gas. If they are asking any difference from this, then you can write this characteristic property and you can write their differences. You may get question like all the metals are malleable, but the exception is then you have to write zinc. So this exceptions are important. They will come in 1 mark or half mark in fill in the blanks or in match the following. Let us talk about molecules. So what are the molecules? When the molecule are formed, so same element or different element combined and they are forming molecule. Here first we will discuss about when the same element are coming together and they are forming a bond, and then it is called a molecule. So first we are talking about same element. Later on we will talk about different element. So when same elements, for example hydrogen is an element. So one hydrogen is making a bond with another hydrogen and they will make H2. So this is a molecule and this is an element. So this is a hydrogen and this is a hydrogen. Covalently they are making a bond. So this collectively known as molecule of hydrogen. They have combined with a chemical bond. So they are known as molecule. This is a one molecule of hydrogen. Here two same elements have joined together and they have made one molecule of hydrogen. Two elements are coming together and forming a molecule. So here first we are talking about monoatomic molecule. Monoatomic molecule means it has only one atom in it and they are independent in the nature. They don't need any other element to support and to become stabilized. So they are known as monoatomic molecules. Because they are independent in the nature, we call them molecules. So from metal, sodium and magnesium are monoatomic molecules. Under noble gases, all the noble gases are monoatomic molecules because they are independent in nature with one atom. So that's why we call them monoatomic molecule. Neon and argon. You can note down all the noble gases here. Now when we are talking about diatomic molecules. Diatomic means in one molecule there are two atoms. That means it is diatomic molecule. Under this, iodine, bromine, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, all these are diatomic molecules. So this element's atomicity is 2. When we are talking about atomicity. Atomicity means this element is stable under this many atoms. That means when hydrogen is there, when one more hydrogen will combine with it, then it will make H2. This molecule is stable. So atomicity will differ from element to element. So all these elements are having atomicity of 2. Iodine's atomicity is 2, bromine's atomicity is 2, hydrogen's atomicity is 2 and oxygen and nitrogen's atomicity is 2. Again, what is an atomicity? Atomicity is a number that number of atoms are coming together and form a molecule. That is an atomicity for that particular element. It will vary from element to element. So all these elements are having atomicity 2. When we are talking about polyatomic molecules, polyatomic means more than 2. So in this category, ozone is there and phosphorus is there. In ozone, oxygen's atomicity is 3, phosphorus atomicity is 4. because in this four atoms of phosphorus are coming together and forming a bond. So this is phosphorus and we require four atoms to make molecule of phosphorus. So atomicity of phosphorus is 4. When we are talking about sulfur, sulfur's atomicity is 8. So 8 atoms of sulfur are coming together and making one molecule of sulfur. So atomicity will differ and atomicity will applicable to only for same elements molecule. You cannot combine carbon and oxygen and making and you can say that atomicity of carbon dioxide. No, it cannot work like that. Atomicity is only for the same elements. When same elements are coming together and forming a molecule for that element is known as atomicity. So how many number of atoms you require for that element, that is, that count suggests you the atomicity of that particular element. Now this is all about when same elements are coming together and forming a molecule. Monoatomic molecule, diatomic molecule, polyatomic molecule and atomicity. All these concepts are related to when same elements are coming together and making a molecule. Now we are talking about when different kinds of elements are coming together and making a molecule. For example, carbon dioxide. So atoms of different elements combines and forming a molecule, that is known as compound. When we are talking about compound, for example carbon dioxide, then you can say that this is a one molecule of carbon dioxide. In one molecule of carbon dioxide, one atom of carbon and two atoms of oxygen are combined. So this is one molecule of carbon dioxide. But this molecule has been formed from two different kinds of elements. So it is also known as compound. So when we have talked about molecule, we know that molecules are formed from two different types. One is from the same elements, other one is from the different kinds of elements. When we are talking about the same elements, under same elements we have monoatomic, diatomic and polyatomic molecules and we have atomicity of molecules. Then when we are talking about different kinds of elements which are making molecules, those molecules are known as molecules of compound. So now let us discuss about compound. Let us understand what is a compound. When two different kind of elements are coming together, two or more kind of elements are coming together, then they are making a compound. Compound are always formed by different kind of elements and they are always combined with a chemical bond. So that is known as compound. So what are the examples for compound? Water molecule, then carbon dioxide molecule. These are the example of compounds. Now let us understand the characteristic properties of compounds. They are always in definite proportion. We know that when any compound is being formed, then it has to be in one definite proportion. I have earlier explained you that when one molecule of water is like this, then there are two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen are chemically combined. If it is H2O2 or it is HO2, then these two are not a water molecule. This is only the water molecule. Why? Because two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen are combined. So this means they are in definite proportion. If we are talking about water, then it has to be H2O. So they are always in definite proportion. Then they are homogeneous. They are homogeneously mixed. then are one of a kind. Compounds are one of a kind means if you are talking about water molecule, then anywhere on the earth the water molecule will be same as H2O. If you are changing your place and from one continent to another continent, then the water's formula is not going to change. So that means it's a one of a kind. That means water molecule is H2O only. Definite set of property. Each and every molecule, when we are talking about compound, each and every compounds are having a specific set of properties. So those properties will remain same for each and every molecule of that particular compound. So they are having a definite set of properties. Next characteristic, elements do not retain their original property. That means, let us take one example, iron and sulfur. When these two will mix together and they will form a compound, iron sulfide. Now when they are separate, when they are in the element form, what are the characteristic property that iron we can separate it through magnetic separation? If we are mixing these two by physical means, then after that, when you want to separate them, just if you will rotate a magnet upon this mixture, then your iron will be separate out. Why? Because iron has a property to attract toward magnet. Now, when we have a compound iron sulfide, these two elements are combined with each other by chemical means. That means they have chemical bond within them. Till now we were talking about only mixture, when these two were separate. Now, when they will combine, then after that if you will pass a magnet or rotate a magnet upon them, you cannot separate iron from them. After a chemical bond, after making a chemical bond and making a molecule of iron sulfide, iron is no more attracted towards a magnet. That means iron's property has changed after becoming a molecule of iron sulfide. How this has happened? Earlier they were separate, earlier they were in the form of element, where iron was possessing its own set of property and sulfur was possessing its own set of property. Now when they are mixing together, they are chemically combined, they are forming a molecule of iron sulfide. Now it has its own set of property. So iron sulfide is different from iron and sulfur. Same thing you can check for NaCl. Chlorine is a harmful gas for human. Sodium metal is very very reactive. If it will come in contact with water, it rapidly will burn. So they are two possessing this kind of property. But when they are making a chemical bond, when they are making a molecule of NaCl, it will become salt and it is edible for humans in their food. We are having salt daily in our food. So, and salt is necessary for our body. So earlier sodium and chlorine was possessing some different kind of properties. After being a molecule of sodium chloride, they have its own set of property. Can be separated? Yes, we can separate iron and sulfur by chemical reaction. Any compound, if it is attached with a chemical bond, then we can separate it with a chemical reaction and we will get our elements back. So this is all about characteristic properties of compound. It is very important, if they will ask you a question like write a chemical characteristic properties of compound, or you have to write it down in a difference, when they will ask you write a difference between molecule and compound or element and molecule or element and compound. Now let us understand that when any such kind of difference will come, then what all points we will write. This is a consolidated table for the difference of element, compound and mixture. So if you will get a question to write a difference in between any of the two from this, you will be able to write by remembering this 4 points for each. So first is element. So this one point is same for this three, that we are talking about atoms in element, compound and mixture. So first point we are talking about is atom. What are kind of atoms we will have in elements, compounds and mixture? So for atoms, element contains one kind of atoms only. If we are talking about hydrogen, then hydrogen has only one kind of atom. Then what about compound? Compound contains two or more kind of atoms. We know that carbon dioxide, then carbon and oxygen. These two different kind of atoms will be there in compound. So now what about mixture? It contains two or more kind of element or compound. Mixture can be of two elements like iron and sulfur, or it can be a mixture of iron sulfide and a sand. So there are two different compounds, there are two different elements. So mixture contains two or more. Mixture is containing always two or more components, then only it is called mixture. So it contains two or more kind of elements or compound. So this topic is entirely for atoms. So what kind of atoms will be there in elements, what kind of atoms will be there in compound, and what kinds of element atoms will be there in mixture. Now we are talking about in second point that can we separate them or can we break them? That we cannot break any element, then we cannot break any compound by physical means. Break them by physical means, but we can separate them with chemical reaction. So we can separate them with chemical reaction. You can mention that if you want it. Then we can separate them by physical means. Now all this physical procedure like filtration, then evaporation, all those procedures are physical procedures. So we can separate mixture by physical procedure. But if you want to separate a compound, if you want to break a compound, we need only chemical reaction. We can separate them only by chemical means, but not by physical means. Next point, will they retain a property? What all atoms are there in elements or compound or mixture? How about their characteristic property? So elements have their own property. They have their own set of property. Now about compound. Compound's components property will differ from elements, and compound has its own set of property. So it will differ from the elements, and compound has its own set of property. Then about mixture, components retain their original property. If iron and sulfur we are mixing, then we can separate iron by magnetic separation, because iron has retained its property even though it has mixed with sulfur. So components will retain their original property in mixture, but in compound they will not retain their property. Now for example, element hydrogen and carbon, and for a compound H2O or carbon dioxide. You can write any of the mixture here, mixture of iron and sulfur. So like this you can remember the points, and it will be easy for you to write down the difference between any of this two. First, we have solid-solid mixture here. Earlier we have discussed in my video, which is based on the overview of a chapter, we have seen that there are 4 to 5 types of different mixtures, and all those mixtures we can separate by different techniques, and these techniques are based on which kind of components are mixed here. So for the separation of mixture, and this mixture type is solid-solid. When one solid compound is mixed with another solid compound, then those kind of mixture we can separate through 4 different techniques. So first technique is sublimation. We know this technique because we have studied this in 7th standard. Then magnetic separation. Name itself suggests that we can separate iron from the mixture, and it is magnetic separation. This is also very easy. The two new techniques we are going to study, that one is solvent extraction and other one is fractional distillation. So one by one we will study this technique. In this techniques, this diagram is important. Explain the sublimation technique by which you can separate the solid-solid mixture. So in this you have to draw a diagram. So let us first start with the sublimation. Sublimation we are using when one of the component, here in all this procedure we are assuming that we have only 2 solid component to separate. That means our mixture consist of only 2 solid components, and these 2 solid components are evenly mixed with each other, and we are going to separate them. So in first, when one of the component is sublimable substance. Now what are the sublimable substance? The substance, by heating them, they will directly converting into gaseous state. Those substance known as sublimable substance. So when one of the sublimable substance is mixed with non-sublimable substance, then only we can perform this kind of technique to separate them. So in this technique, what we are doing is one funnel, we are inverting it on a petri dish, and in the petri dish we are taking a mixture of A plus B component. Now what are this A plus B component? One, we are taking NH4Cl. NH4Cl is ammonium chloride and it is sublimable substance. That means when we are heating this component, from solid it is directly changing into gaseous state. And another one is NaCl, that is sodium chloride. When we are heating this mixture, then one of the sublimable substance will convert it into gaseous state, and we can see the deposition of this substance in inside layer of funnel. When we are keeping this inverted funnel on the petri dish, the reason for that is whenever this substance will be gaseous, then it can deposit over here. And why it is depositing over here? Because the funnel surface, the inside funnel surface is cooled one. So they will stick to this surface of the funnel, and once our heating will get over, the sublimable substance will be separated and it will be deposited inside the funnel, and whatever lying behind in the petri dish is our NaCl. So this is one of the technique by which we can separate sublimable substance and non-sublimable substance. Now all these techniques are very specific and they are working as per the condition basis. Why? Because when one substance is sublimable and one substance is not, then only you can use this technique. So this is a condition for this technique. Now second is magnetic separation. We know that the condition for this is one of the components should be iron, or one of the components should be which can be attracted towards the iron. So that is definitely only one ore, and that is iron. When iron is mixed with sulfur, and this mixture we can separate through magnetic separation. We are taking here in one petri dish the mixture of iron and sulfur, and when we are moving a magnet on them, all the iron ore or the powder of the iron will stick to the magnet, and we can easily separate the sulfur and iron. Now third technique is solvent extraction. Name itself suggests that what we are using in this technique. This technique's condition is one of the solid component should be soluble in the solvent. So here we are taking sulfur and charcoal. So this mixture is consist of sulfur and charcoal, and we are taking a solvent, carbon disulfide. So sulfur is very much soluble in carbon disulfide, whereas charcoal will not be able to soluble in the carbon disulfide. So when we are getting this type of mixture, then we have to choose solvent, like one of the component of the mixture should be soluble in that solvent. So we have to choose a solvent according to our mixture. So now here our solvent is carbon disulfide. So when we are mixing this two component, A plus B component, with our solvent, our components are sulfur and charcoal. When we are making them soluble in this, charcoal will not get soluble into this. So after that, in first step, we will mix them along with the solvent, then we will filter it. So we will recover at the first step our charcoal, and it will be in the filter paper. Now in this solvent our sulfur is dissolved, so in next step we will evaporate this solution and we will crystallize this substance, and it will recovered in the crystalline phase. So in first step we will mix them, then we will filter it, because sulfur will get dissolved into this and charcoal will not. So we will get a charcoal on the filter paper, that we will let it dry it and recover it. In the second step we will evaporate this solution, so solution will become hot saturated solution of sulfur, and we will recover the crystal of the sulfur and we will filter it. In the next step also we will filter it, so we will get the second substance here. So there are two step procedure. So this is two step procedure for solvent extraction. First we are mixing them with the solvent, one of the component will get dissolved, we will filter it, and the second component which is soluble in the solvent, we will recover it through evaporation. So here the basic condition for this technique is one of the solute or one of the solid substance should soluble in the solvent, then only we can do this technique. Now the last and fourth technique is fractional distillation. In this, when both the substance are soluble in one solvent, then what we can do, we can check their solubility. There should be some difference in their solubility. Means one substance is highly soluble in the solvent and the other substance is less soluble in the solvent. In this kind of condition, we can perform this fractional distillation. This is the basic difference between solvent extraction and fractional distillation. In this, one substance is not at all soluble in the solvent, whereas here both the substance will be soluble, but one is less soluble compared to other one. So here we have taken two substances, two solid substances, that is KNO3 potassium nitrate and KClLO3, that is potassium perchlorate. So these two we are dissolving in the solvent. So first step is we are making a hot saturated solution of both, because both are soluble in the solvent. So we are making hot saturated solution, and then we will allow it to cool. So when it will cool down, we will get the first substance here. We will recover this substance as a crystal, and that is potassium perchlorate. This is the less soluble substance, and we will get it first in the first step. Now in the second step, so one substance we have already recovered. Now in the solvent, in the filtrate, the other substance which is more soluble is still is in the solvent. So we are heating the filtrate and we will allow it to cool. So again, when we are heating it more, it will become more and more saturated. So when we are allowing to cool and it will cool down, after that we will recover our second substance. This step is also known as crystallization, and we will get this substance here, and this is highly soluble substance and more soluble substance. So in the second step we will get our second substance. So first we made hot saturated solution of this two substance, then we will allow it to cool, we will filter it, then again we will heat it and we will get crystal of second substance. So these are four basic techniques to separate solid-solid mixture. First one is sublimation, in which one substance has to be sublimable substance. Second technique is magnetic separation, in which one substance has to be iron or it should be separated through magnet. Then third is solvent extraction, in which one of the solute or one of the solid should not get dissolved in the solvent. In the fourth technique, the condition is one solute is highly soluble and the other solute is less soluble in the solvent. So this four techniques are for solid-solid mixture separation. In this, there are four basic techniques, that filtration, sedimentation, evaporation and distillation. So one by one we will learn each and every technique, and we will see the basic condition or the necessity to use this technique. So first is filtration. It is very easy technique. When one solid substance is insoluble in the solvent, then we can perform this technique. So here the condition is the solid substance should be insoluble in the liquid component, then only we can perform this technique. Simply we will put the filter paper in the funnel, and through the filtration technique we can separate solvent and solute. Solute we will get in the filter paper, later which we can dry it and we can recover the solid substance, and here in the beaker from the funnel we will get our solvent. So when a solid substance and a liquid will get mixed and the solid is insoluble, then we will perform the filtration technique. Now here the same thing will be there. Our solid substance is insoluble in the solvent, but it is not mixing with the water. It is heavier compared to water. So what will happen? Once we will leave this mixture undisturbed, then the solid will settle down. So in that we don't need filtration. When we need filtration, when some of the substance is lying down, some of the substance is floating over the solvent, and some of the substance in between the solvent, then we can perform filtration. But when a solid substance is very heavy, then once we will leave it undisturbed, it will settle down. So we can take out the upper layer of the solvent through sedimentation. So we will lift it, tilt this beaker. You can see here this solid substance is lying down here. So we can little tilt and take out the solvent through sedimentation method. Here we do not need filtration technique because the solid substance is heavier than solvent. Now third technique is evaporation. When a solid substance is soluble in the solvent, in this two technique it is insoluble, in this it is heavier than solvent, and here the third one is when solid is soluble in the solvent, then we can perform evaporation. Here evaporation means we are completely evaporating solvent and we will recover our solute. So we cannot perform this technique in a glass vessel, or we cannot do this in a beaker. We have to do this in a sand bath. So this is a sand bath, and in the sand we have kept a petri dish. In the petri dish, our mixture is that is component A plus B, and in A plus B, this is a solution mixture of NaCl and water. So we are keeping here a solution in a petri dish because the solvent is completely going to evaporate, and what will be lying behind is our solute. This we can perform when a solute is soluble in the solvent and solvent is not very costly. We should afford that solvent to evaporate, then only we can perform this technique. If solvent is very costly, then we cannot afford this technique. So here the water is there, so we can perform this technique. Once the water will evaporate completely, in the petri dish we will get a salt. So this is how we can recover a solid when solid is soluble in the liquid. Now the third technique is distillation. When our solvent is very very costly, some of the organic solvents are very costly, even they are costlier compared to the solute. So in that case we cannot afford them to evaporate. So in that case, when you want both solvent and solute, then we will perform this technique. When you want only solute, then you will perform evaporation. These two techniques we can use when solute is soluble in the solvent. Now here, this is an assembly, or this is how we are arranging our apparatus when we are performing distillation technique. So this is a round bottom flask. Through that, this distilled tube is going to a conical flask. So in this, we are keeping our mixture A plus B. Now what is our A plus B? That simply we are imagining that we want a pure water. So here the impurity is also there in the water, or we can also take lead nitrate mixed in the water. So here we have taken a mixture A plus B. When we will heat this round bottom flask, slowly the water will evaporate. It will condense through this condensation tube, and drop wise it will come to conical flask and we can collect it here. So once the whole process will get over, here we will get the impurities or a solute in the round bottom flask, and here we will get our solvent. So by this technique we will get both our component at the end, but in evaporation we will get only solute. So one more time we will revise these four techniques. These four techniques we use to separate solid liquid mixture. That means in our mixture there are two components. From that, one is solid, the other one is liquid. So in these two techniques we are using when solute is not soluble in the solvent. So first is filtration, when the solute is not soluble in the solvent and it is mixed with the solvent, then we can use filtration, or it is lighter than the solvent, then we can use filtration. But when it is heavier than solvent, once we will leave it undisturbed, it will settle down, then we can do sedimentation. We can little bit tilt the beaker and we can take out the solvent. Third technique is evaporation technique. When solid component is soluble in the liquid, then we will evaporate the solvent and we will recover our solute. This technique is distillation, when our solute is dissolved in the solvent and we need solute and solvent both at the end. So this is our distillation assembly. At the end, in the round bottom flask we will get our solute, and in the conical flask we will get our solvent. So the basic difference between these two is, in this we will lose our solvent and we will recover the solute, whereas here we will get both at the end, and that too in separated manner. We are going to learn about a separation techniques of
liquid-liquid mixture and complex mixture.
Let us start with the first technique, that is separating funnel, and second technique, that is fractional distillation. In this category, that is liquid-liquid mixture, we have to study two techniques. First is separating funnel. When two liquids are immiscible with each other, immiscible means they are not well mixed with each other. When you are mixing them, then they will, after some time, then they will separate easily. For example, oil and water, they cannot mix with each other. They will separate automatically. Oil is lighter than water, so it will float on the water. So this kind of liquids, when they are mixed with each other, we can separate them through separating funnel. And we also know this mixture as immiscible mixture or immiscible liquids. Immiscible means which cannot mix with each other. So in this, we are utilizing this separating funnel. This funnel is having a cork at the end. So when we are adding a mixture of oil plus water into this, we have to leave it for some time so they will separate easily, and we can see a two distinguished layer of water and oil. Then after some time, we will open this cork and we will allow this layer. This will be water, because oil is lighter than water, so it will be on the top of the water. So we will allow this layer to come out from this cork and we will collect it in the beaker. And once this layer is completely finished, then we will turn off the cork. So in the separating funnel, oil will be left behind and we will take out the water from this. So this arrangement we will do for immiscible liquids, in which we can separate the liquids which cannot mix with each other. So this is one technique. The second technique is when two liquids are easily mixed with each other. That means they are miscible liquids. They are well mixed with each other. So how can we separate them? So for them, we are utilizing fractional distillation. But this technique we can use when the difference of the two liquid is more than 25 degrees centigrade, because we are going to heat them and through their boiling point we are collecting it. So the difference should be more than 25 degrees centigrade. Let us see how can we do that. So here we have taken a mixture of benzene and toluene. Benzene's boiling point is 80 degrees Celsius and toluene's boiling point is 110 degrees Celsius. So in this round bottom flask, we have taken a mixture that is A plus B, benzene and toluene. Once we will start heating it, we have to continuously check the temperature also. It will start boiling and the first liquid which will evaporate will be benzene, because its boiling point is 80, it is lower than toluene. So once we will achieve the 80 degree Celsius temperature, it will evaporate, it will condense, and we will collect the benzene here. We will collect the benzene in the conical flask. And once all the liquid, that is benzene, will evaporate and come through this distillation assembly and to the conical flask, this temperature we have to maintain. And after that, once the 90 degree temperature we will achieve, we will switch off the flame and we will collect all the benzene here. So once we will switch off at 90 degrees Celsius, we will imagine that the whatever benzene was there in the mixture, we have collected over here, because its boiling point is 80 degrees Celsius and we will go up till 85 or 90. But after that, we should not rise a temperature so that it will get impurity of toluene. So whatever left behind in the round bottom flask will be toluene, and whatever we are collecting is benzene. So this is the technique by which we can separate two miscible liquid through their boiling point. But
The difference between the boiling point should be more than 25 degrees Celsius. Otherwise, the first liquid will evaporate and it will get the impurities of second liquid. So this boiling point should be more or less away of 30 to 35 degrees Celsius. Then only that liquid will be lying behind and the other liquid we will collect over here. Once this liquid will evaporate, it will travel through this condensation tube. It will cool down and in drop-wise manner we will collect the liquid A here. So these are two techniques which we are utilizing to separate liquid-liquid mixture. When we are talking about liquid, we have to see that whether liquids are miscible or immiscible. Based on this category, we can choose our separation technique. Now we are going to study about two types of mixture, that one is liquid gas mixture and gas gas mixture. So first let us study liquid gas mixture. When any gas is mixed with a liquid, then boiling the liquid will help us to separate both the components. When we are boiling a solvent or boiling a liquid, it will decrease the solubility of gas. So when a mixture of carbon dioxide and water will be there, then once we are heating the water, once the water will start boiling, the carbon dioxide gas will easily expel out. So in liquid gas mixture, when we are increasing the temperature, the gas will separate out from the solvent. Now under gas-gas mixture category, there are two techniques. The first is diffusion technique and second is solubility in solvent. In diffusion technique, we are using porous partition. So when we are going to use this technique, when from two gas, one gas is lighter and another gas is heavier. So when we are passing this two mixture from porous partition, the lighter gas will travel fast and the heavier gas will left behind. So this is how we are going to separate these two mixture. Now in solubility of solvent, the both gases we will try to get dissolved in the solvent, and from this two, one of this gas will not get dissolved in the solvent. So here we are taking mixture of hydrogen chloride gas and nitrogen. So when we will dissolve this mixture in water, the hydrogen chloride gas's solubility is very high in the water, whereas nitrogen is insoluble in the water. So this gas we will get it in the water, whereas nitrogen will expand out. So this is how we are going to separate a mixture of gases through solubility of solvent. So in liquid gas mixture, only one technique is there, that you will increase the temperature of solvent and gas will separate out. Whereas in gas-gas mixture, there are two techniques. First is diffusion and another one is solubility in solvent. Moving towards our next topic, that is complex mixture. Now in this category, there are two different types of technique. First is chromatography. This technique is used when many soluble components are present in solvent. So how can we separate it? So chromatography is a technique which we can use when many soluble components are present in one solvent. Earlier, what all technique we have seen, in those techniques we have used only two components. Those mixtures were of only two components. Here, many solutes are dissolved in one solvent. So for that we are utilizing technique known as chromatography. So in this, suppose there is an ink and we are taking a black color ink in which it is a mixture of many colors. So in the filter paper we are putting a drop of a black ink. You can perform this at your home also, that a black sketch pen you can take and you can put a one dot of black sketch pen ink on the filter paper. Then you have to hang that filter paper in the water
and it should not be completely dipped into a water. It should only touch the surface of the water. So slowly, slowly that water will get absorbed by the filter paper, and after some time you can see that as the water will get absorbed, it is travel towards the top of the filter paper, and along with the water the components of ink will get separated. You can see the green color, pink color, blue color will get separated from the black color ink. So this is how we are utilizing this chromatography technique when many solutes are soluble or got dissolved in one solvent. So this is complex mixture because there are many solutes present in one solvent, and this technique is known as chromatography. This chromatography is based on the color separation. Chroma means color. The separation of colors and techniques which we are used to do this is known as graphy. So that is chromatography. So this, all this substance we are separating based on their colors and their travel time. So this technique is known as chromatography. The second technique is centrifugation. We know this technique very well. We are separating cream from the milk through this technique. And in the laboratory, a centrifugal machine will be there, and it is something like this, in which there will be place of test tube and the colloidal solution, which cannot be separated through filtration or evaporation, we are separating through centrifugation. When cream is mixed in the milk, then we cannot separate through a filtration or sedimentation or any of this technique. We have to perform centrifugation. In this, we are utilizing centrifugal force. In centrifugal machine, there are places for a test tube in which we are placing a test tube and we will rotate it at a high speed. So after some time we can see that solute and solvent has been separated. When we will separate the cream from the milk, we can see that cream is floating on the milk, and we will separate that solid component from the milk. So this is centrifugation, in which we are utilizing centrifugal force and we are separating soluble solids from the solvent. So this kind of complex mixture you can separate through two techniques. One is chromatography and other one is centrifugation. We are going to learn that how to remember all the separation techniques, its important condition and their related examples. These topics are from ICSE Standard 8 syllabus, from the chapter Element, Compound and Mixture. In my previous videos, we have studied all these separation techniques thoroughly. I have given link of those videos in the description. If you have doubt in any of the technique, please refer those techniques in the detail and then come back to this video to learn that how to remember each and every technique along with its important condition. So basically there are many techniques and we are utilizing those techniques based on its condition. This condition will tell you that when you can use this technique. So this is important because this condition can be asked in fill in the blanks, multiple choice question, and write a technique name in which one solid is insoluble in the solvent, or one solid is soluble in the solvent. At that time you have to identify that separation technique based on the condition, and this chart will help you to remember that technique, because this is all the information together. Here I have noted down examples also. So once you will remember this, it will be very easy for you to understand the whole chapter and along with the correct information. You can take a snapshot of this detail and you can remember it later. Let us first understand that how this is going to work. So all these mixtures are here. This is solid-solid mixture. So in this, there are four type of techniques In solid-solid mixture, there are four techniques. Now, when sublimation we are using, when we are using this sublimation, in this I have mentioned one solid, one solid, one solid. That means from the mixture of two solid, one solid has to be sublimable. Then only you can use this sublimation technique. So, in MCQ, in multiple choice question, if they are asking you that, write a name of the separation technique of solid-solid mixture in one of the solid is sublimable, then at that time you have to write this technique. And if they are asking that, write the example of solid-solid mixture, then you have to write this, that ammonium chloride is mixed with NaCl. In this you have to remember that ammonium chloride is sublimable substance. Second is magnetic separation. This is very easy. One of the solid has to be iron and the example is iron plus sulfur. So from this you can write the full technique also. If they are asking in 2 marks, that describe this technique without diagram, then you have to mention the example that from the mixture of iron and sulfur we can separate iron through magnetic separation. You cannot describe any technique without example. So examples are mandatory. Third is solvent extraction. In one of the solid has to be insoluble. And here this is our solvent, carbon disulfide. And sulfur and charcoal is there, in which sulfur is soluble. So first you can filter out charcoal and then we can later evaporate the sulfur. Then fractional crystallization. Here in solid-solid mixture, this is fractional crystallization, and here in liquid-liquid mixture, this is fractional distillation. Both are very different technique. So you have to remember that this is fractional crystallization. In this, both solid are soluble in one solvent, in which one is less soluble, the other one is highly soluble. So from this example, the potassium perchlorate is less soluble. So we will get this first and later we will get the highly soluble solid. Then in solid liquid technique, solid liquid mixture, there are again 4 techniques. This is very easy. First is filtration, when solid is insoluble. Sedimentation, solid is insoluble and heavy, so it will settle down. Evaporation, solid is soluble. Distillation, solid is soluble. Now, what is the difference between these two? At the end, you are going to lose your solvent in evaporation. You will not get your solvent back. And in distillation, we will get a solute also and we will get a solvent also. So, you will get a question like distillation is preferable over evaporation. So, you can write the answer like in distillation we will recover our solvent and solute both at the end, whereas in evaporation we are going to lose a solvent. We will only recover the solid substance. So distillation is advantageous over evaporation. Now next is liquid-liquid mixture. When two liquids are mixed, there are only 2 possibilities. Either they are miscible or they are immiscible. If they are miscible liquids, the condition is if they are miscible liquids, then we are going to use separating funnel. We will leave it aside. We will allow it to separate the layers and then we will take out the one layer. And when the liquids are miscible, then they are evenly mixed with each other, then we are going to use fractional distillation. And in this, the example is benzene and toluene. You have to remember this particular example. Otherwise, in filtration and all, you can write example by yourself. But here you have to mention this too, because their boiling point difference is more than 25 degrees centigrade. So we are utilizing the fractional distillation technique to separate benzene and toluene. Next informations are about liquid gas mixture, gas gas mixture and complex mixtures. So in liquid gas, only one technique is there, you can increase a temperature of liquid of a solvent and whatever gaseous component is dissolved in it will expel out. Here the example is carbon dioxide and water. When in the water a carbon dioxide is dissolved and you have to separate it, once you will start heating the water, the carbon dioxide will expel out. So here the condition how you are doing it is increase the temperature, and example is carbon dioxide and water. Here condition won't be applicable to that. Now gas-gas mixture, there are two techniques. One is diffusion and second is solubility in solvent. So in diffusion, the condition is one gaseous component should be lighter than another. And the example is hydrogen and oxygen mixture. Here we are using a membrane and here we are using a solvent to separate them. So one component is insoluble in the water. Here we are taking a solvent, water. So one component will be soluble in the solvent and other component won't be soluble in the water. So hydrogen chloride gas and nitrogen we are taking as a mixture. So hydrogen chloride gas is very well dissolved in the water and nitrogen gas will not get dissolved. So like this you can separate these two mixtures. So condition is one component is insoluble in the water. The third type is complex mixture. So these two are the techniques are under complex mixture. In chromatography, different solutes in one solvent will be there. And in centrifugation, we are using this technique, a centrifugal force to separate a colloidal solution, which solute cannot be separated through filtration and evaporation. Those kind of mixture we are separating through centrifugal force, and this technique is known as centrifugation. So this is all about how to remember all the technique along with its example and their respective conditions. Don't forget to subscribe, learn yourself, stay tuned, keep learning, keep sharing.